You just said that you were gonna take The Rock straight to school. School. Well, The Rock could just imagine what you were like in high school. The oldest 27-year-old senior the world has ever seen. Standing out in front of your house with your mama and that short little yellow bus pulling up in front.
Meep, meep. Meep, meep. Meep, meep.
You just walk in on the bus going to class. Getting inside the classroom, teacher up on the blackboard. Okay, class, what is 2 plus 2? Do you know Booker? Okay, I know the answer to that. 2 plus 2? Thomas Jefferson, sucker.
Got holes
in different area codes.
Area codes.
Holes.
Holes.
Holes. In different area codes.
Area
codes.
Now you thought I was just 770 and 404? I'm worldwide, bitch. Act like y'all know. It's the abominable ho man. Globe Trot International Postman, neighbor Dick Dope Man. 718s, 202s, I send small cities and states, IOU. 901, matter of fact, 305, I'll jump off the G4, we can meet outside. So control your hormones and keep your drawers on, till I close the door and I'm jumping your bones. 312s, 313s, 215s, 803s. I'll read your horoscope and eat some hors d'oeuvres. 10 on pump 1, these hoes is self-serve. 757, 410s, my cell phone just overload.
I've got holes.
I've got holes.
In different area codes.
Area
codes.
Holes.
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 Welcome, everybody, to Chapter 5 of the Invasion Diaries. I am, of course, your host, Meals, and we are here, and we are back, and, of course, for the third time. I mean, I don't know. You're the recurring guest host on this. It's just because it's easy and you want to talk about it, and it just makes it completely easy.
More than that, people love hearing you and I link up on.
Yeah, I mean, that's true. That's true as well. I mean, yes, we have that in common as well. We got something in common.
Are we doing the yeah. Bobby and Whitney?
you know what they had in common, right?
Oh my god.
You know, rest in peace, Whitney Houston. Nonetheless, we are here for the Invasion Diaries. This is Chapter 5. If you guys have been following thus far, we covered the fall of WCW. This might be Chapter 6. Hold on, let me fucking see. All right, so we got the first episode was the fall of WCW, which you were on. Shout out to you.
Oh, yeah,
second episode, the fall of ECW and the rise of the Alliance. The third episode was the Invasion 2001. Shout out to Carlos for being a part of that. And
funny,
then the fourth
episode, hilarious episode, by the way.
Thank you. My favorite part was when Carlos said he's seen Buff Bagwell for the first time and was like, who is that Puerto Rican nigga? And of course, the fourth episode had with Amp and Mark, where we talked about where Mark kind of revealed his true stand card. I mean, he pulled it out and he had it like flailing and powerful for The Rock. The return of The Rock, which was an unforeseen episode. But now, with the return of The Rock, with everything kind of mounting, with everything kind of looming, we are now entering SummerSlam 2001. And while it's not the time of recording this, I'm sure by the time we release this, SummerSlam will be a few weeks away. I always hold a special place for SummerSlam in my heart. Yeah. Maybe it's because I went to three of them.
Never been. I think this year will be my first one.
Good. Good. Because SummerSlam is amazing. SummerSlam is truly the WrestleMania for people who don't want to pay WrestleMania prices. You know what I'm saying?
This year, them niggas gonna be paying WrestleMania prices.
Oh, God. Yeah, in that football stadium, I bet. But with that said, I mean, I don't need to hear about Justin's 2001. We already heard about it on prior episodes, but yeah. Let's talk about what life was like in 2001. That's my favorite segment. Like, I say this every episode, but it's true. My favorite segment, what was life in 2001? Okay. Are you ready, sir?
Let's do it.
Some of this is wrestling-based, so some of this I think we'll be able to enjoy and analyze and break down, but then some of this is, like, you know, other stuff. MTV 2001.
Oh, boy.
I want to do a little exercise here.
Okay.
We can talk about the shows that MTV had in 2001, and we can determine whether they could still be shows today.
Wait. So you mean that Ridiculousness was not a thing in 2001? What?
No. Wait, first of all, they have Ridiculousness. What do they have? Deliciousness?
Yes.
And then
the challenge?
I think they also just added, I was watching MTV earlier, they're adding Adorableness, which is a show about kids doing the darndest things.
No.
Yes, they are, bro. Yes, yes. I mean, I'm sure by the time you hear this, it'll be out already. But yes, they're adding Adorableness. It's a whole brand.
I'm gonna put my dogs on that then.
MTV in 2001. All right. So what? Before I get into the list of the programming, what do you remember about MTV back in the days when you kind of watched it back in, you know, turn of the millennium type of thing? What do you remember? What are your fondest memories?
Man, the shake your ass video. morning videos, and in general, I was like, you know, on the way to school, I turn on 5 o'clock in the morning. You get morning videos, you get premiere videos 5 a.m., 6 a.m. before they start doing the morning programming. So that was my biggest and most fondest memory of MTV was getting my school clothes on and watching videos. It's one thing that I feel like, you know, people today don't see that they don't get to experience, you know what I mean? And that to me was very before iPods and iPhones and shit like that. I know I'm sounding old here. It's like, yo, this is what pumped this up. Like, I could turn this up on the TV and get ready and go, because we could just turn on the TV and get music, you know what I'm saying? That was the crazy part about and see music. So it was that. Obviously we got to talk about, like, was it Direct Effect at this point? I think it was Direct Effect at this point.
It was Direct Effect. Direct Effect is definitely on this list.
Direct Effect at night. Obviously, the TRL was not at its peak, but it was definitely still popular at the time. MTV original programming was still hitting. Real World was something that me and my sister watched, you know, faithfully at the time. Road Rules as well. I think that a lot of my prepubescent, you know, teenage, middle school years were MTV. This was my channel of choice. And, you know, 2001, I mean, obviously the show's going to get to that, you know, terrible point in American history, but that was the channel that I watched during the whole thing. You know what I mean? So, like, yeah.
Absolutely. Okay. Well, let's get into the program. Let's see if this could certainly live today. And that's also my thing with MTV as well. I remember 100% the kooky music shows, the making the video type things, which we don't even get anymore. Like, you get BTS's on not the group, but, you know, behind the scenes thing on, like, an artist's YouTube, but you would have to be subscribed to their YouTube. On MTV, you could just see the whole making of the video, and they did the countdown, and it's like, oh my god, yes, fuck, we're finally, you know, the moments they had. I mean, Busta Rhymes video, Britney Spears video, all types of things. Music, the M in MTV used to stand for music, and there was a lot of it on MTV. Nonetheless, a lot of these are featured in the 10th spot. A lot of these are featured outside of that. Shout out to MTV's 10th spot. 2001, the 10th series in of The Real World. And you know where they were. And you know how this is very important to me, because it's one of the first Real Worlds I watched in full. Mm-hmm. Real World Back to New York.
Yes, sir.
Oh, it's relevant. Oh, it introduced us to, first of all, not only one, but two reality TV icons.
Mm-hmm.
In The Miz and Coral.
Yep.
Oh, my God. I wish it was on Paramount Plus still. I don't know why they didn't put it, but part of me thinks it's because I do believe they worked at Arista Records in 2001 for that Real World.
Yes, they did.
So it might be a lot with them like trying to clear a lot of the stuff that was there.
Yeah, but the thing is, when you go back and watch it, it almost feels like they weren't actually doing anything important for Arista. They were only doing like
filing and paper.
Yeah, yeah, street teamwork. They were making like 525 an hour.
Yeah, because on Real World, they didn't pay. I mean, they paid you obviously for like, so you could like keep your rent in your house and stuff like that, but they didn't actually pay you while to be on the show. You had to work for your actual money. Like,
yeah.
So they had jobs, and I think if you were at some point, if you were fired, you were kicked off the show. I believe so.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They had jobs because I remember the San Diego season. They had a like, didn't they work at like the zoo or aquarium or some shit?
Yeah, something stupid like that.
Yeah.
Like, no, wait, San Diego. Well, San Diego. Oh, yeah, definitely that. But then they had, so, you know, Quan is also watching Real World Austin, which I was a fan of, and they were working South by Southwest, mm-hmm. which was like before it became
what it
the
is.
Mass sponsorship hub of all of music. So that was always fun. So we had the Real World Back to New York, which is my personal, one of my favorite Real Worlds. Coral is just, you just need to look up Coral on YouTube. Whatever you can find, it's amazing.
Coral was my crush, like my big crush. You know what I mean?
She was, I remember even being young and being like, looking at the Miz at that time, I'm sorry, Miz, but being like, that white boy getting creamed every time he opened his mouth. Because the Miz was from Cleveland, which is apparently the middle of nowhere where there is no diversity, which is like nothing at all. And she was really the culture shock that kind of brought him into like 2001. And it's like, excuse me?
Nicole's having a house meeting today because she wants to talk about the noise levels.
I know I'm going to get woken up. I'll probably get woken up every night. But I know like every single time she stopped herself and was like, oh, Nicole's asleep. I mean, just that consideration is cool.
But I know that's not all the meeting's going to be about, because I'm going to confront Coral and some of the other girls about how rude they were to my friends.
These are like my friends from school, and I brought them here. And like I introduced, like for you, for instance, I introduced them to you. Peace. And you left, and I was just like, wow. You know, I mean, like, you could at least say, you know, if anytime you bring someone over here, I always say, you know, like, your little cousin or,
She's 13, huh? And I didn't call her panty-dropping freak before she got here.
And, what?
Don't tell me to respect people that you don't even respect.
Please. I respect them.
No, you don't.
Yes, I do. Don't
bring this. Sit back.
No.
You don't want to even get there.
No, I'm
chill out.
No.
Chill out, Mike.
I'm chill. But
so used to everyone just accepting me and knowing all my humor, and in the house, like, people just don't get that.
Like, you don't understand the term panty dropper in my mind and all my friends.
I understand panty dropping freaks, and oh, one of them's gonna drop their panties tonight. I don't understand all that.
At home, I have hundreds of friends, and here I have six friends, and that's it, and some of them don't even like me.
Like, you don't have to talk to them, but you don't have to sit there and laugh at them.
I'm a grown woman. Don't tell me how to act. I'm an adult. You're more rude.
Yeah,
because you're telling me that they're your friends and you talked about them like dogs, like whores.
I'm talking like dogs or whores.
Okay. Call him right now and tell him you called him so stupid that when you talk to him, you feel dumber. Call her and tell her that. And see what she's more offended by. Me saying peace or you, her friend, calling her stupid.
I shouldn't have said that. I saw blonde, and I guess I stereotyped her a little bit, and so it was wrong of me to say that. Mike is in the doghouse, bad. I guess Coral got him that one. Round one goes to Coral.
Hello, my treacherous friends. Well, thank you for joining me here tonight. I brought you all here to discuss, as I must, how pleasant it's been this demise.
But Coral would also, because I'm going to get into this next one as well. Road Rules, of course, the companion show to Real World. This season was Road Rules the Quest. So it was a companion season to Back to New York. But before they casted for the Real World and Road Rules, I don't know if you remember this, but they used to do the casting special.
Yes.
So they would have like 24 people and they would determine who's going the Real World and who's going the Road Rules. And it's actually in full on YouTube.
Oh, wow.
Literally. The full 90 minutes of it is available on YouTube.
Just think about what would have happened if they put Miz on Road Rules instead of Real World. Like how shit would have changed.
I think he would have been as popping.
No, exactly. Like he wouldn't have had the reckoning that the Miz. I wouldn't say reckoning, but the lessons that he had to learn on that season. He wouldn't have. I don't necessarily think he would have learned if he was, you know, doing laps and fucking skydiving or some shit.
Yeah. No, you're right. You're absolutely right. Next one. I don't know if you remember this. MTV Becoming. Do you remember this?
Yeah, I do.
Oh, you remember? Oh, my God. Wow, you have great memory.
It's when the kids, they want to become like an ice skater, and then they get the most popular.
No. That one is Made. This is Becoming. So I'm gonna reintroduce you to this concept.
Okay.
MTV Becoming. Have fans reproduce music videos by their favorite artists.
Yes, yes, yes. And they're like, way cheaper.
Yeah. OD cheaper.
They're like, what? Somebody did, because they even had gender swaps too. Like, didn't the dude do a Britney Spears video one time?
Yeah, and they would do like Jessica Simpson and Nick Lachey and like Missy Elliott and like all this other stuff. Like, a fan who just becomes and it was OD cheaper, like ridiculously cheaper, because who's paying up to $1 million to reproduce?
That's how crazy it is. Like working in music, like I have for like the past decade, I know how hard it is to clear these songs. So clearance must have just been the Wild West back in the day, because they on this show they were using the like multiple parts of these songs in this like throughout the whole episode. I'm like, bro, that's like and you know, when you work music, every time you play a fucking song, you got a 200 every time you play it.
Yeah,
for how long you play it, it's money. So like they're playing, it's so crazy, bro. Like it, like just thinking about how that show was even made.
Absolutely. Next one, of course, Real World Road Rules Challenge. This is the early days. This is like pre-Miz, because you know, the Miz was on Real World, everyone was on Road Rules and stuff like that. But they had the challenge. I think this one was the Extreme Challenge, which I believe Real World actually won. A very rare time that Real World actually won these Real World Road Rules challenges. God, that was a ton. Next up, Direct Effect.
Mm-hmm.
Hosted by... No, not yet. Hosted by Tech Money.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Awkward.
Come on.
He didn't last long. I know that.
No.
He didn't last long.
And why do you believe so?
I don't know anything background on it, but I knew from a kid he didn't seem comfortable interviewing the people that he would interview on the shows did not be comfortable with him. He just did not seem like the type of guy that should have that position. He didn't have any credibility, so to speak.
Right. No, you're 100% right. I think because Tech was the coolest back then. He just was, and it's good that we got to see him on Real World on the Challenge All Stars, because I don't know where they found Tech, because he has been missing for the last, if 2001 was 20 years ago, probably like the last like 19 years.
They'll find you.
So
because they'll find you just off the fact that when you do things for companies like MTV or Viacom, they keep a running tab on where they got to send the checks to. So they'll
right,
you know, they get a social security number and all that. They'll find them.
Absolutely. Next one, MTV Diary.
Classic. It's the precursor to the vlog.
Yeah, because it seems like very, very forward now that I'm thinking about that. Like I look at, they're on Paramount Plus, but there's only one season and there's only like 12 episodes.
You know,
so
what?
I watched. Why?
Got to clear the talent. You probably didn't have to do it. Or if you did, it wasn't as many hoop shoes as you had to go through back in the day.
Jesus Christ. I hope Jay-Z clears this episode, but
you got to clear them. Like you got to clear them through like record contracts, agency contracts, all of that stuff you got to go through now to clear people to do these types of shows.
Jesus Christ. And anyway, I wish they bring back MTV Diary, because MTV, well, I don't know how actually interesting people's lives are in 2021. Like, what do you, like, people actually, like, back then everyone had, like, when there was a street team, they were on the street. When you were doing promotion, you were doing promotion outside, and you would see them, like, their off days. I remember there's one with Pink that's on Paramount Plus, and like, she's going into a store and just like buying random outfits. But it's from New York, and it's clearly from, and I know New York as much as I know New York, it's clearly like a touristy ass store. So I was like, what the fuck is she doing in there? She's like buying outfits to like go out the next day and like their day off. And it's like, you think you know me, but you have no idea. MTV Diary. Really good show. Really, really good show. If best anyone has this, go ahead.
Best episodes, Chris Rock, because he was in character the whole time. Nothing better than, sometimes I just like to steal, and then he first to steal.
And then they put the words on the screen, like, sometimes.
Yes, sometimes I just like to steal. Also, I mean, obviously, like, RIP, the Kobe Bryant episode was great. But the thing is, and I know, you know, time, you know, whatever. But the funniest thing to me about that episode is always when he puts his finger up and he says, all right, don't even try, ladies, I'm taken. And shows his wedding ring. And then, like, literally, like, 2-3 years later.
Oh, my God. The incident of all incidents. Yeah.
I want to go back to that and be like, yo, famous last words, brother. Because you was never the same after you said that.
Absolutely not. I mean, they had so many classic MTV Diaries. I mean, anytime you saw Britney Spears on this shit, they had Method Man and Redman. They had Aaliyah. Kind of like everyone who was anyone at this time was doing an MTV Diary. It was cool to do. Like, this was, the MTV was cool. I swear to God, MTV was cool. Like, it was.
One day. At one point, they were the pulse, in a way that I feel like, and this is a deeper, way deeper conversation, has nothing to do with the show, but like, in a way that like Complex tried to be the, like, everything is trying to be the new MTV. Complex trying to do a Revolt, trying to do it. They're trying so hard. I think the only actual network that actually does succeed to some extent because of the original content and the tone and the tenor of it is VH1. They're the only ones that match that energy of MTV. Chaotic energy, young energy. VH1 is it.
Right. Reality energy. I mean, they kind of got it on lock. They have a whole slate of, they have a, it's a movement in a sense.
It is. And people are going to laugh at that, but I'm like, yo, there was a time where MTV did have a different reality show every single day of the week. And that's what does VH1 have? What does VH1 have? Because when Real World dried up, Jersey Shore took its place.
But then they also had so many, like, you remember the Newlyweds with like Nick Lachey and Jessica Simpson. They had the Osbournes. What else? Like, during the reality TV boom, I could do an entire episode on like the random shit of the mid 2000s. But yeah, I mean, just so much stuff. MTV had so much stuff. We talked about making the video, so they had that. MTV News Now, which was a news program that they actually had, that they would talk about the news.
Yeah.
Which MTV wouldn't dare touch today.
They can. I mean, they fired everybody. They fired everybody.
True Life had some good shit.
Which is on Paramount Plus in an extremely abridged, truncated way. There's like seasons up, but they're very like maybe 2 or 3 episodes out of the season.
During this era, I would say, all right, so I'm looking at list of True Life episodes. Episode 23, I'm on Ecstasy. Episode 24.
Classic episode. Do you want to talk about how much I watched True Life? They actually have some of my favorite episodes on Paramount Plus, though. The one where you're in a complicated relationship, where the dude lives with the girl and he don't got no job. And like, people with the white girl, she's like, we got a lot of problems, dude. Like, that is a classic episode. True Life, I'm addicted to porn. True Life, my mom is a porn star. There's a lot of
true life.
So
true life. There's a true life. I'm a backyard wrestler.
Yep.
True life. I'm a private wrestler that I'm seeing. Wow.
Yeah. What that mean?
True life. I'm getting plastic surgery. True life. I'm coming out. True life. I'm in therapy. True life. I'm going to fat camp.
Mm-hmm.
True life. I was famous for 15 minutes. They had everything, and this show went for a while. It apparently, let's see. Wow. I mean, they still had episodes, consistent episodes, kind of leading up to 2017, which I would have never known.
Yeah.
But that's crazy. Of course, WWF Sunday Night Heat, the MTV WWE connection that will. Do you think you ever see? I mean, there's no point on being on MTV right now if you're WWE. I mean, WWE is always looking for places to increase their audience.
Mm-hmm.
But I think MTV's, their whole scheme is like, let's play shit that's cheap that we can play forever.
Yeah, well, this was the first, to be honest, the first time WWE really reached out to try and get a mainstream audience and to be in that position.
There's the WWF Sunday Night Heat, and there's Tough Enough. So I just want to mix them together.
They tapped into the pulse of what was popular. It was very rare that they did that. Because remember, like Meals, like they wouldn't do another thing like this for another 15, 16 years.
Mm-hmm.
They're just now starting to do this again with Miz and Mrs. and all of the things that they're doing for Netflix and all this other stuff. They're just
and shit. Yeah,
exactly. They're just now tapping back into that type of content. Will we see another original, you know, multi-camera show for them, reality show from them? You know, who knows? The sky's the limit. But you know, who knows what Nick Khan is planning? But you got to remember, like, WWE was a zeitgeist in 2001. Even if the ratings weren't where they were, it was part of the lexicon of American TV. It was NFL, NBA, WWF. That's what it was.
Absolutely. Absolutely. MTV Cribs, classic show.
They have a lot of episodes of that on Paramount Plus as well. I know this sounds like a big plug for it, but the first week I got it, I watched everything.
Yeah, I watched every episode. I don't know why. So I'll tell you the other show that I reach for because it's on this list. But I went for Diary first. I didn't watch MTV Cribs first because they have a lot of actually on YouTube, a lot of YouTube content. They also have like a lot of episodes of Punk'd on YouTube, which is it's not 2001, but it's damn close, and just doesn't age. Some of them don't age well. Some of them are still hilarious, but a lot of the stuff you can't get away with today. Especially like. They always talked about that one with the Black Eyed Peas that never aired, where they got they were getting like essentially like harassed by some cops and they fought the cops.
Yep.
And it never aired. So MTV Cribs is always a classic. I just go back to it. Classic episode, Red Man episode, easily.
Of course, yeah, that's a classic. That was the first one I watched. You know what one was terrible? The Trina episode. It was terrible. She didn't even seem like it was her house. Another funny one. Was the Jason Williams one. And if you know Jason Williams, you know that he killed a man in his backyard.
Oh my God.
The NBA player. And he actually.
This is where the magic happens?
Yeah. No, so they go. He actually drives into the field where the crime is supposed to have happened, and this crime happens like maybe what like a year or so after this episode.
Uh-huh.
It gets dark when you look at MTV. Like, but also another one of my favorite episodes is Ice-T's house, because his house seems like a house that would still be in demand today. Like Ice-T's house is really really dope, and I like that episode a lot.
All right, I'm going to definitely watch that. MTV Say What Karaoke.
Oh, my God. You know,
That was a Saturday afternoon type of thing.
Wasn't the guy Dave? Wasn't his name Dave?
Dave?
No.
Yeah. No, that's the director.
It was Dave something. He was a rotund white guy.
a random Dave. You know what I'm saying?
He was like, he was one of the VJ Search guys.
Dave Holmes.
Dave Holmes, yeah. He was a VJ Search guy who lost to Jesse. Then they realized Jesse was not going to make it. Jack, we got to do a whole pod on the VJ Search on the Patreon. I would love.
No, we definitely need to. I want to find it. Where is it at?
We got to dig deep. We got to dig deep for the VJ Search, because people don't realize that MTV, like people who are like younger on the Patreon, they don't realize that the VJ Search was a major cultural experiment. It was a whole show, and then the fans voted the worst person. It was between him and Dave. And Dave,
they voted the person who looked exactly like he acted. And poor Dave, who was probably like, I would say Dave Holmes at this time, maybe like late 20s, maybe early 30s, but yeah, a professional nonetheless.
Yes. Bro, it was the most embarrassing. Like, Dave's face was like, there's no way the fans literally voted this motherfucker. And they did, and he was gone or doing something else in less than a year. And Dave had the most popular show on the network. Like that
next. Say what, Karaoke. It was a karaoke show on live television where no one can sing. But you were nonetheless judged by a group of singers at some point.
Yep.
As you butchered their... It was... What's that fucking show on TBS? Hosted by Chrissy Teigen and LL Cool J.
Lip sync battle thing.
There you go. Yeah. There you go. It was like that, but like, I guess, I don't know, younger? Not celebrities? Just literally random people? next one, Dismissed.
Yeah.
Dismissed was a green show.
That was
very green.
Green. Super green.
I mean, you take two people on a date and you have to dismiss one of them. Each of the daters, okay, I'm reading the synopsis of the show. One person simultaneously takes two others on a date. Each of the daters chooses a place to go, total of two places, and the person running the date dismisses the person he or she likes the most. Each of the competing daters has a timeout card. When used, the card is allowed to the card allow the competitor 20 minutes alone with his or her date. So three people going on two separate dates.
Oh my God. Okay, Meals, yeah. There is some wannabe a VJ content on YouTube.
Okay. Link me that and we'll definitely watch it, and I'm 100% down to talk about it.
Absolutely. Okay.
I love classic MTV shit. Up next, the Andy Dick Show.
would not have survived.
No.
I love that we do this to get people in the mood to talk about the 2001 WWF, because there's like with SummerSlam 2001, like, which is it's a big card, 9 matches, but like a lot of this card is inconsequential. Like, a lot of it means nothing. A lot of this means nothing.
Oh my God. The Andy Dick Show definitely would not have survived today. It starred comedian Andy Dick, who, let me look him up.
Oh God.
Still alive.
Yes, he's still alive.
He's 55. I thought he would be older. I thought he'd be like 60 something.
Wow. That's more of an indictment to him than you think.
Cause he looked old then. No, he was actually like late mid 30s then. Yeah. I don't know. Whatever. Shout out to him, I guess. 2001, the final season of Daria.
Yeah. Classic. Yeah. I watched the final episode. I said fucking skipped. I never seen the final episode, so I watched it again.
I'm still like working through the season. I need to like actually sit down and watch it, but I've been sitting down and watching too much 2001 wrestling and anime and all types of other shit that's taken me out of this.
Yeah.
Celebrity Deathmatch.
We could do a whole show on this.
I was all right. So I was in on Celebrity Deathmatch, but also out on Celebrity Deathmatch, because like some of them weren't really. Some of them I didn't want to see. I don't know.
Yeah, some of them were whack. I mean, was Marilyn Manson like the most undefeated nigga on that show?
Maybe.
Like, never lost.
Maybe. Him or Stone Cold Steve Austin, which we'll talk about a little bit later.
He never. But like, he never fucking lost on that show. It was
Austin didn't job into flesh or claymation.
Exactly. With that, but again, another WWF connection. Like, I think 2001, and I think I get the point you're making here, is that 2001 was where the WWF MTV collaboration really saw the fruits of his labor, because a lot of people probably started watching it because of the connection they had with MTV.
Absolutely. 100%. And even though WWE was starting to, you know, it was starting to trend a little bit down towards the ratings, they were still, I would say, at the peak of their powers in 2001. The biggest WrestleMania we just came off. We just talked about a couple episodes. The biggest non-WrestleMania pay-per-view at the time, Invasion. 770,000 buys for a pay-per-view that was ass. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
They were at the peak of their powers. And then the final one, MTV Rockin' Jock, which, considering how much content is out of celebrities playing basketball against each other,
way too much.
It sorely needs a return. I watched Jason Derulo versus Chris Brown the other day.
What?
Don't ask why. Yeah, it's on Revolt. They have teams and everything.
Oh, that's like Drewski's does one of those, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Drewski and I think Jack Harlow are the announcers for that, which is perfect
doesn't
tandem.
Doesn't Jack Harlow have other stuff to do than be a comedian?
No. he's trending towards affable white guy. He's going to get he's doing like his real rap shit, and then he's also trying to get in his fuck, what's the name of that Lil Dicky shit? You know what I'm saying? Is like,
yeah, he also about to say it's gonna be Dave pretty soon.
Hi, <I'm Dave. laughs> it's gonna be Dave.
Hi, I'm Jack.
all right, so we can browse through these next two ones. These two are wrestling related, so right. And I knew you would appreciate this. 2001 PWI top 500 wrestlers.
All right, okay, here we go.
2001, who do you think was number one?
Austin.
Close. He was number two.
Rock?
Rock is number 14.
Whoa. Oh, yeah. They didn't like niggas. Benoit.
Benoit's number three.
What the? Oh, Angle.
There you go. Kurt Angle. Number one.
Those are literally, those are literally like the top four.
Yeah.
For niggas back in the day.
Oh my God. All right. So we'll go through. You know what? Top 20, I'll count them down really, really fast.
Okay.
20, Edge. 19, Diamond Dallas Page. 18, Toshiaki Kawada.
Okay.
17, Jeff Hardy. 16, Kane. 15, El Hijo del Santo. 14, The Rock. 13, Lance Storm. Whoa.
This was grasping straws at that point, nigga. Seriously?
Was this the time where he had like 8 titles? Might have been. 12, Genichiro Tenryu. Not even sure who that nigga is. 11, The Undertaker. 10, Rhino. 9, Chris Jericho. 8, Mitsuharu Misawa. 7, Scott Steiner.
Mm-hmm.
6, Triple H. 5, Booker T. 4, Kaiji Muto. 3, Chris Benoit. 2, Stone Cold Steve Austin. And 1, Kurt Angle. Anything jumped out at you?
No, it seems about right. Other than The Rock, which is weird, but The Rock
was out doing movies.
Yeah,
and getting his ass whooped by Triple H.
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah, he was out most of the year. So I get it.
Yeah, I'm not gonna go through much of this list, but it's a very interesting. I mean, PWI is the same shit. Like, you can get one guy who's part of a tag team who's higher than the other guy part of a tag team. Like, everyone is on it. Everyone you know is on it. The next one, this might be interesting to you. The Ohio Valley Wrestling Roster 2001. Oh my God. These are staples of the upcoming Ruthless Aggression era. So we're moving forward in this. Listen, 2001. Sean Spears. No, I'm kidding.
That would be fucking hilarious. All right, so number one, they have Damaja, who would later be known as Danny Basham.
Basham, yeah.
Yeah, and he was a very... Before he became a Basham, before both of them became a Basham, they were actually reputable wrestlers in OVW. Two, Randy Orton, of course. Number three, Rico Constantino, who would be known later as Rico, mm-hmm. The publicist, stylist. What was he?
He was the stylist.
I think a Rico character would get off today.
Oh,
don't
no.
you think?
Oh no, you're right. You want to see that discourse?
Rico, listen. Put them in NXT. Then put him with what's homegirl name?
Frankie does.
There we go.
That would be dope if she had like a stylist that would cheat for her. That'd be dope.
I think it would be amazing. Four, Rob Conway. A reputable OVW wrestler.
Look at me. There's another guy. Ain't I a son?
Amazing. The peak of his career. And it only lasted like 9 months. Next one was the Machine, who would be Doug Basham. Brock Lesnar, of course. Nick Dinsmore, who would be known as Eugene, who never got a chance to be Nick Dinsmore in WWE ever. Would you be mad if you saw Eugene show up randomly in 2021? Randomly. They call him back for whatever apparent reason. How would you feel? Would it work today?
He putting on 4-star matches?
No, the character Eugene. The character Eugene.
Is he putting on 4-star matches?
He might. Shit. You might.
Because that's what Eugene was doing back in the day. Quiet as his cat.
Eugene out here. Eugene. We got to have a talk about Eugene. We're going to do a Eugene watch one day. Shelton Benjamin, also featured on this. Johnny Spade, who would then, I think, be known. No, actually not John Morrison. I thought it was one of his other Johnny names.
Uh-uh.
Forget me.
He was part of the he was part of Tough Enough.
There we go. Yeah. Right. Mark Henry. Remember they sent Mark Henry to OVW? I was like, nigga, you better work. Let's see what else. Leviathan, known as Dave Bautista.
Yeah. Leviathan.
David Flair. You know how that went. David Flair's. Do you remember David Flair's only WWE appearance?
No.
He got beat up by The Undertaker in a build to WrestleMania 18.
Yeah, he did.
Undertaker shows up to the tracks and beats the shit out of him.
Yeah, he did do that. You're right.
It
was like, they hired you, nigga? And then they sent him to OVW.
They sent The Undertaker to him. It was like, we beating this nigga's ass. Prototype, John Cena.
John Cena, of course. Yep.
Easily. Bill Buchanan. But he wasn't
B-Square.
Wasn't on the show. He was being Bill Buchanan. Let me see if there's anyone else of note. I know they sent Mark Jindrak to OVW because he wasn't ready yet. They felt like who else? I think Jazz had a no. I think all of these are end up being appearances on just like people doing appearances. Oh, Queen Victoria. Mm-hmm. Can't forget Queen Victoria. She was a hoe, and then they made her into a wrestler.
Oh, I was like, what? Wait, what? I was like, oh, yeah.
Yes, she was a hoe. And then she'd be one of Godfather's hoes.
Can you say it like that and not she's a hoe?
Sorry, Lisa. I'm sure it was a great point. She was like, I'm sure she talked about it very lovingly and very openly. Like, yeah, I was a hoe, but you know what? Guess what? Like,
this hoe got paid.
There you go.
This hoe never gets cold.
They also had a ton of people who actually work for OVW and not WWE, who I don't care to talk about. But, you know, OVW wrestlers, the beginning of Ruthless Aggression era. We've wasted enough of you guys.
We wasted time. Like an hour.
Enough of you guys' time. You know what we should get to? SummerSlam 2001.
Boom.
Okay, before we get into everything, how do you feel like the invasion is going up to this point? Because we talked about kind of everything that's going on this far. They seem to have a kind of general you know, the beginning of it was rough because clearly they're flying by the seat of their pants. Now there seems to be kind of a direction to it. How did you feel like it was going, at least at this point, building up to SummerSlam?
I think that it started to pick up when The Rock came back, and it's picking up because of the talent involved. I mean, you look at this card, you look at the pay-per-view right before it, it's like day. You know what I mean? It's like, oh, okay, they're actually right. You know, they have stars again.
And they're positioning people like, you know, Rhino and Rob Van Dam. A lot of people are getting actually positioned into, and then we actually, after Invasion, you would start seeing the defections. So they would start making up for the lack of WCW talent by putting WWF guys within the alliance.
Exactly. And I think that when you really compare it to the beginning and then what will come after this, this is definitely the peak of what they were trying to do.
Yeah. Easily. After Invasion, Stone Cold Steve Austin, of course, he betrays the WWF. He's a WWF champion, Booker T, WCW champion. Everything kind of seems, you know, going their way. Then The Rock returns, who really adds a jolt to the whole WWF. And he's supposed to be essentially saving the WWF moving forward. You see a lot of title changes moving around. Because honestly, I think they had a lot of title changes because they were trying to position this card. Because there was a lot of, I forgot who was hardcore champion before Rob Van Dam, but it really didn't matter because Rob Van Dam ends up being probably the most pivotal hardcore champion
next to them all.
Yeah.
yeah.
He's a hardcore champion who actually had a WWF championship shot, I think, during his reign. I could be wrong. Forgive me.
He was too over, man. And you see it on the show. He's too fucking over, bro. Like, he's just truly a goat, man.
They end up giving the WWF Tag Team Championships to DDP and Canyon. For what reason? I'm pretty sure just to do this match. And the WCW Championships to Undertaker and Kane. For what reason? To build up to this match. And there's just a lot of things that's going on. I think probably the only thing that's painfully missing from the show that you can't even compare to 2021, women. And we more than talk about it. I'll definitely talk about it in a future episode because I plan on doing the winners and losers of this whole thing. And I think one of the major losers to no fault of their own was the women because of the whole China Women's Championship entire thing that kind of happened that they weren't really featured on any of the shows.
Holding it hostage. I think one of the, and to be clear, I'm a fan of China, you know, for what she did for the game, but that was a downside of her being in the game. Like it just wasn't clear to me, or didn't seem like she wanted to actually defend
work with the women.
Yeah, she didn't want to work with women, and she had that belt and that title like held hostage, and to the detriment of actual, you know, the women. Like it, on this show you get, I think you get a tag match between the Alliance and WWF women, but it was just like, it wasn't for anything. It was like 2 minutes long. It didn't really mean anything. You know what I mean? But
no, I mean, there's not even, well, at the Invasion show, you definitely do. But I think after, I mean, Trish Stratus gets injured shortly after. Lita, the Hardys aren't even really featured on the show except Jeff Hardy for good reason. So yeah, there aren't a lot of women present except Stephanie McMahon. There's not much female presence on this show. Let's get into the intro, because this is one of the sickest intros to pay-per-view ever. We talked about the MTV and WWE connection. Boy, did they love fucking Drowning Pool.
Especially this year.
Oh my God, let the bodies hit the floor. I remember I would sing that because it was a fire song, and I think they had the great build to it. You look at the music video of Drowning Pool, and they blended into the WWF footage and stuff like that. And then later in the night, they do this, which they don't do anymore. I think the last time we saw this was maybe like Keith Lee versus, was it Karrion Kross or Adam Cole, where they did a whole music video to actual music to build up this thing.
Oh, it was Adam Cole, I think.
Yeah. So they don't really do this anymore, but we had that entire build up thing with Drowning Pool. I mean, and then it would become associated with ECW pretty much moving forward. Like, fucking Paul Heyman loved this song.
Years later. Years later, too, which was insane. Like,
past its prominence.
Exactly. Eight years later after this seemed like a fucking eternity. It could have been goddamn 2014 and it still would have been too old.
Oh my God. God, you know what? I'll talk about this afterward. We'll get into another song that's featured a lot during this era. First match. Way to kick off a pay-per-view. Lance Storm.
Yeah.
Didn't see it coming. Nonetheless, Lance Storm versus Edge, Intercontinental Championship, kicks off the pay-per-view. I think a good way to start this pay-per-view. I mean, we're still continuing to see the Edge and Christian split being played on TV. But I think Edge is getting more accustomed to his singles bag. Like, especially with the moves, like the execution, I think this was really one of the major debuts of Edge-O-Matic, all types of other stuff like that. How did you feel about this match, at least watching it?
Yeah, it was definitely well worked. It's clear to me why Lance Storm landed so high on that PWI list. He was definitely one of the wrestlers that would give you a really 3-star or above match. And I think at the time, Edge wasn't known for matches like this. Like, we know Edge now is kind of like the technical, but also character guy. He's more character guy here. And Lance Storm is helping him work through that. And I mean, for the IC title, like he gave it a lot of prominence for the little bit of time he had it. But I thought that they had a really good opening match. And this is the type of opening matches that you want, where it's like, okay, you got to give Team WWF one good win here. And then they end up at the Edge. I thought it was good.
Absolutely. And then you would see at pretty much Lance Storm would be used kind of like as an auxiliary player moving forward. I mean, you talk about his run with the Un-Americans, you talk about tag team champions with William Regal, a whole bunch of other stuff like that. And we know the career that Edge would go on to have and what would happen afterwards. Funny part after the match, Grandma calls Edge, or Grandma calls Christian. Christian says, "Hey, Grandma."
Lord Jesus, these vignettes. You know what's funny? They don't do this anymore. So when it's jarring to me that when I see this, I'm like, this could have been on Raw. You could have kept that. Like, I actually like that they don't do that type of shit anymore.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. I kind of liked it. I like the fact that, first of all, they're leaning into the fact that they're brothers. Because no one's brothers anymore in WWE. Everyone's fucking... just people in tag teams. Grandma calls Christian. "Hey, Grandma, I got a European." "Oh, you want to speak to Edge? Okay." "Yeah, Grandma, I won. Yeah, tell Grandma Edna. Yeah, we'll be up in Calgary in a few weeks." Passes the phone back to Christian. Grandma? I love that. I don't know. It's just something small that I love. Next matchup. Testing the Dudley Boys versus Spike Dudley and the APA.
Yeah.
First of all, I want to say heel test is really kind of where he lands. Because I'm not sure. When he was first introduced to WWF, I think the general consensus was, he's green as fuck. And he's just, but he's big, damn it. Like, he's huge. And he would have these impressive moments. But I think the asshole test is truly where he land. You know, rest in peace to Andrew Martin thus far. But yeah, when he has that pre thing with Michael Cole and he was like, "Come listen here, you little bitch." You know what I'm saying?
I heard him spit out roids when he said that. He said that.
Oh my God. Nonetheless, I mean, it's a 6-man tag. We don't really have these much on today's show either. They don't do random 6-person tag team matches like that anymore. Like, everything kind of has a purpose. Most things are singles matches, to be quite honest with you. But this was a story where Test was getting revenge on the APA for beating his ass, even though he wasn't the mole. They would actually find out the mole was Paul Heyman, and Paul Heyman relishes in that. And then APA getting revenge on Spike Dudley for apparently stealing their shine with his... with his tramp girlfriend, as they would say.
You just don't get storylines like this anymore, man. I swear.
No. They gave everyone everything. Like, this is the equivalent of this today might be, wait, the equivalent of this today would be the War Raiders and Jackson Riker versus Elias and AJ and Omos.
I guess, bro.
But you know what that match doesn't have? Spike Dudley, who's willing to die every time. That table spot is going to be gold. It's not even a tables match.
I was scared for him, bro. I was really scared for him, dog. Like, I know he was crazy, and I've always known he's been like a wild nigga, but like, this was like, he was doing some dumb shit for nothing. Who would think that we'd be talking about this in 2021? Like, do you think he'll get like a fucking ding? Like, ding! Like, I got some money because they remember this dumbass table spot I did.
Will he ever be inducted into the Hall of Fame? Answer that question.
He never will. Never. As a janitor, maybe. Never. Like, a real nigga. Nah.
Stop. We appreciate all your sacrifices, Spike Dudley.
Yes,
Shane McMahon gets
your self-inflicted sacrifices, nigga.
Shane McMahon gets involved at the end of the match, hits Bradshaw with a jumping steel chair and costs him the match to win the Alliance their first match of the night. So that was a fun little wrinkle that would end up playing out later. Next one, X-Pac versus Tajiri for the light heavyweight championship.
Tajiri?
Tajiri.
And this would be like a kind of a unification match because X-Pac was a cruiserweight champion. Tajiri was a light heavyweight champion. And they were just going to put them together after this because this was for all the belts.
So here's the thing, though. You know who Tajiri won the light heavyweight championship from?
No.
X-Pac. X-Pac was a two-time double champion. And no one cared. Not a single soul. He literally wins the belt back from him, which is insane. I'm interested to know X-Pac's role around this time. Because, you know, I don't know if it's because of the writers. I don't know if it's because maybe there was a lot of influence with, like, DX and Triple H and a lot of stuff like that. If there was, rather. But X-Pac's role in the light heavyweight division, moving from, because he was a contender for Intercontinental Championship, he was always kind of at the top of the card, he's been known as an amazing worker, why do you feel like he was like kind of put into this light heavyweight division? It's kind of it works, but it's kind of weird. It actually kind of plays out like the China and the women's championship type of thing as well.
Yeah, they just couldn't get him away from that, you know, from that division. And I think that Richard always said this, like, X-Pac was the guy that you faced when you first got to WWF to see if you could go. And a lot of people went through him, and a lot of the smaller guys went through him, because I feel like still at this point, they were still kind of iffy on the smaller guys in a lot of ways. So I think you make him look good here. And I think that was the X-Pac detriment too, because he, like, this nigga always won. Like, I don't think people realize, anytime I turned around, he was always fucking winning. And I had no clue. I
beat Kane multiple times.
I'm like, how the fuck does this little nigga keep winning? I never understood it. But I think that was a major part of the story behind him just always having a place. And I mean, politics might have had. But could you say it was politics at this point? Like, Shawn was not there. Triple H was not there. You know, Nash and them weren't there. It just seemed like they just really trusted him to run with it.
You know, it kind of feels like the whole Neville and the Cruiserweight Championship shit as well, where it's like, we need someone to help kind of like anchor this division somehow, because we're bringing in a lot of cruiserweights, we're bringing in a lot of light heavyweights as well, and we need someone to kind of anchor it. But, I mean, he really doesn't recover from this. I think by September 2001, he's not even with the company anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then the light heavyweight championship gets moved out and the cruiserweight champion becomes essentially the championship.
Yes.
So, you know, this is probably one of the last pay-per-views that we see X-Pac on, but, you know, solid performance. I like Tajiri, you know, I think he's super entertaining during this era as William Regal's, right-hand man.
I don't know what, This wasn't like an Alliance versus WWE match either. It was like,
no, this was WWE versus WWE.
Yeah, it was, and that's what made it weird too, because it was like everything else was not that on this show. But I can't say that the wrong person won, the right person won. It seemingly quick to me. It went around 7 minutes. I think I clocked it at, and
yeah,
it was inconsequential. X-Pac wins again and gets both belts.
X-Pac could have been in the Alliance. Like, I think it would have worked out, to be honest with you. But he probably just didn't want to be any part of WCW or anything, or really part of Losers, actually.
Oh, yeah. He didn't fuck with none of that. None of them.
Yeah. What's your thoughts on this recurring Sean Stasiak shit throughout the night?
Hilarious. I think a lot of it is hilarious knowing where it ends up and like what ends up happening. It's like, damn, they really thought he was about to be the one, huh? We shall see.
Sean Stasiak is trying to be motivated by Deborah and Stone Cold Steve Austin, and trying to be motivated means attacking all of their enemies. He ends up running into so much shit, not actually laying a finger on Kurt Angle nor The Rock during the entire night. It's fucking hilarious. Next match up after this one, Chris Jericho versus Rhino. No championship on the line, but still a lot of a war of words, which has led to Stephanie McMahon backing her, I guess, her most prominent or one of her most prominent ECW guys versus the person who has always been the thorn in her side, Chris Jericho.
Yeah, we are firmly in misogyny territory here. Just the look backs of what he's been saying to her for the past couple weeks are insane. This is stuff that
you talk about. Let the bodies hit the floor.
Yeah.
What about let the boobies hit the floor?
Yeah. Like, all right, bro. All right, bro. You're wild.
We might get into a talk about stepping man's boobies up.
You got to do a super cut of all of the things that Chris Jericho said about her, and then send it in to AEW.
What's weird is Vince McMahon is her dad, and like approving all of this shit. Like, yeah, you gotta say she's a hoe. You know, you gotta say, look at her titties; they're huge, or something along those lines. Like, I'm so confused, but nonetheless, in the bill for this match, it's Chris Jericho giving it to Stephanie McMahon. They had that Planet of the Apes crossover. I don't know if you remember this, where they brought out two apes and pushed the pie in Stephanie McMahon's face.
Yes.
On the Raw prior, they had that was the let the boobies hit the floor, but it was also 1+1 = Thomas Jefferson sucker, which I can imagine was a segment that went way longer than it was supposed to. How do you feel like Rhino was received in this era? Do you think it was the Paul Heyman effect for his
absolutely,
for his role on this card?
I was fucking frightened of Rhino back in the day, yo. I was like, yo, he's the baddest motherfucker on earth. I still feel that way, because I don't think he's ever changed the way he's been like booked. Like, he's the one that, like, even when he was older and he was on SmackDown, all he needed was one spear and he got you. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
He wasn't the tallest guy, but Paul Heyman made him seem like he was 7 feet tall. You know what I mean? Like,
absolutely.
He was incredible talent. I know that him and Jericho were really close. They were really cool, and they had a really good match here. Like, I think this next stretch of the card is actually real good.
It's gonna hit a full stop somewhere, but I agree with you mostly.
Oh yeah.
Chris Jericho versus Rhino. I love the match. You know, Chris Jericho has never beaten Rhino. Rhino's out here demolishing and doing a lot of stuff. I didn't like the whole spot of, like, Chris Jericho obviously hates Stephanie McMahon, but then you also, like, forcibly kiss her as well, which is like, huh, what? Okay. Chris Jericho wins. Walls of Jericho ends up tapping Rhino out.
Running big-ass legs, bro. Like, I was like, what?
Eventually, they repair this on SmackDown. Stephanie McMahon eventually moves on from Rhino and becomes, like, in the corner of Rob Van Dam. And speaking of Rob Van Dam, the next match. I can't even say this is one that stole the show, because there's a fucking match here that's incredible. But nonetheless, Rob Van Dam versus Jeff Hardy in a ladder match for the Intercontinental Championship.
This is one of my favorite matches of all time. One of the greatest SummerSlam matches of all time. I couldn't wait to talk about this.
Okay.
One of Rob Van Dam's greatest matches. One of Jeff Hardy's best matches of all time.
Yes.
Could have been the match of this show had it not been for the main event.
Had it not been for PWI's top one wrestler.
Yeah.
Of 2001.
It spawned so much swagger and so much style and so much sauce for matches like this forever that they still use.
Mm-hmm. I'm glad you said that because they still do this from day to I think the evolution of ladder matches. We talk about Shawn a lot because it was the first ladder match and the amazing things that he did. But I don't think we talk too much about how it kind of was truly innovative and innovated by people like Jeff Hardy and Rob Van Dam, people who would become ladder match would end up becoming the staples of their signature match, essentially.
Yeah.
They go off here. I mean, they went off on the last pay-per-view Invasion, but they go absolutely nuts here. Suplexes. Go ahead.
Yeah. This was the better match to me. Period. And I'm glad they ran it back because it was so popular at that time. Rob is over. Jeff is over. Not a single fucking boo. They had the crowd in the palm of their hands. Also, you know why this rocked so much? It was so different from what we were seeing on this show thus far. And it popped such a swagger, man. It was just, this match is great. I completely forgot it was on this card, to be honest with you. So when I saw it, I was like, oh, fuck. This match that I've watched kind of removed from this show for like pretty much all my life is on this show. So I like sat and watched it. I looked up and everything. Like there was so much stuff that Rob did. And I feel as though that he learned in WWF or WWE that made him better as far as timing, working with Jeff helped, you know what I'm saying? Helped him get that. And it helped him get out of the, you know, out of the ECW mold. He was able to work ECW one more time here, but right. he did it within the WWF confines. And I thought that was really awesome.
Jeff Hardy is 24 in this match, 24 years old. Like, and you know, we see that he will have an actually probably 23. Now I think about it, his birthday is August 31st, but he would have a very, very long career, especially after this match. We still see him on Raw 20 years later. Who would have thought after matches like this, the man takes a suplex off the ladder. The man, I saw a hip toss over the top rope to the outside, which is insane. One of the final spots, which ends up becoming a botch spot, but that's the type of spots you have in these type of, you know, reckless matches.
Yeah.
Where Jeff Hardy's hanging from the rung that holds the championship.
Yep.
And Rob Van Dam is trying to like swing him, so he's swinging in air so he can springboard off the top rope and kick him. Which I was like, what? I was like, are you high?
Yeah. Yes.
Are you a crack? Like. Because he completely misses. there's a spot where Jeff Hardy's I think it's Rob Van Dam is pushed off a ladder and he falls and lands right on Jeff Hardy. Like, this match is a blueprint for one of the best ladder matches, in my opinion, with two of the best guys that you can do it. This is Jeff Hardy in his prime. A lot of you guys seen Jeff Hardy in 2021. If you haven't seen Jeff Hardy prior to like 2008, I'm sorry. You know what I'm saying? But man, this was incredible. This match kind of like put me on like, okay, Rob Van Dam's a guy. Like, he's amazing.
Five stars.
Easily.
There's two five-star matches on this card. This one of them.
Let's talk about a match that isn't five star.
Let's talk about a match that was like, for all the setup, and I know it took a long time because there was a bunch of vignettes between this to set the fucking cage up, but for them to do all of this and it only be like less than like 9 minutes is fucking insane to me.
It felt so long though, because all right, so what we're talking about is the Brothers of Destruction, Undertaker and Kane versus DDP and Canyon, championship for championship, steel cage tag team match. And I, let me tell you this, without fail, every time I doze off during this match, without fail, like
only 10 minutes.
It is so long. It is the longest 10 minutes that I've ever had. Like, this ends up being a 10-minute squash. It doesn't end, it's not like a competitive match. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Canyon manages to escape first. And they use the trick I used to do in all the wrestling games. Let one of the other tag team partners escape and then beat the shit out of the other guy in the cage. I have nothing to say about this match because it's a long squash match that DDP, I don't want to say DDP didn't deserve this, but he's no longer relevant after this match at all.
No. And my big issue is that the handling of DDP was so wrong because I know that there was a Stone Cold equivalent on WCW, yeah. But he wasn't the copy. And I think WWF didn't realize that he was not the copy of Stone Cold. He was the people's champion there. He was the baby face there. And they presented him as some kind of skeevy pervert guy. And it's like, yo, this is not the DDP that I know. Make him. Go ahead.
And the thing is, nah, they changed so many things about the invasion, but then refused to kind of like budge on like, let's make, you know, DDP a lot more. Maybe we have him reckless. Maybe we have him off the handle or something like that. Like, no, you made him a perv. Ugh.
Yeah.
And he got his ass beat down for like apparently 10 minutes.
they got their asses fucking beat. And I guess this was kind of the blow off to the Sarah stuff, which.
Yeah,
I mean, come on! It didn't need to be. This was the worst match on the show, I think.
Easily. The worst is yet to come for Undertaker and Kane, though, because you know what would come after this match, right? You know what's scheduled in the program.
No.
Chronic.
Oh yeah.
Chronic.
Brian Adams and Brian Clark. I think they were both named Brian.
Brian Adams and Clark. Yeah, Adams and Clark.
The only reason I want to talk about this is because I'm probably not going to talk about this on any other part of the thing. I will simply, in terms of how I talk about it, I will simply read their profile on Wikipedia. Well, first of all, I think I'm not even sure one of them. One of them is dead.
definitely one of them is dead. It's wild.
In September 2001, Brian Adams and Brian Clark. This is so Canadian. Are they Canadian? Let me see.
I thought they were American. No. They are Canadian, I think. Yeah.
One's born in Hawaii.
One of them is Crush. One of them is Crush.
Yeah.
Back in the day. Yeah.
All right. So Brian Adams and Brian Clark each made their re-debut as WWF tag team recruited by Stevie Richards. Chronic was called in to settle past differences Richards had with The Undertaker, stemming from the disbanding of the Right to Censor earlier that year. Wow. This is a storytelling that WWE just doesn't do. Chronic wrestled their first tag team match, defeating Kai and Tai on SmackDown on September 20th, 2001. And their last tag team match would be a few days later at Unforgiven, losing to then WCW tag team champions, the Brothers of Destruction.
Oof.
It said, after two dark matches, four appearances on Raw and SmackDown, and a pay-per-view appearance, Clark was released from his contract after being an unconditioned and unsafe during their pay-per-view match. While Adams began working for the Heartland Wrestling Association, which was WWF's developmental territory, he would request his release in 2001.
You're gonna watch that pay-per-view though, right? The one that he was wilding.
So I don't have it scheduled on the thing. I actually don't. So, but I might. I mean, who knows?
He was wilding. He was like, "Fuck this shit, man." fuck this shit, man. It's me.
Oh my god! All right, let's get to the show stealer.
Yeah.
Oh my god, this match. Kurt Angle versus Stone Cold Steve Austin for the WWF Championship. Whew. First of all, the promo beforehand. I mean, you talk about let the bodies hit the floor, everyone's screaming. Ah, let's go. I don't know what I thought when I initially saw this match, or maybe I haven't paid attention to this match in a long time. This is such a fucking good match.
Well, yeah.
Oh, my God.
It's a reason it frequently comes up and not only people saying what was the best match of Austin's heel career, the best feud of his heel part of his career, but also one of the best Austin matches ever. Kurt Angle works here because he is not Bret Hart, to be clear, but he works at a pace and an understanding of the ring like Bret Hart. Like, Austin matches well with guys that at this point in his career moved with his pace. Triple H.
Right. A lot of technical guys.
Yeah.
I mean, I think probably the only outlier would be The Rock, but he worked very, very well with people where he had to kind of, like, you know, he could play off a lot of their technical prowess and kind of introduce his own as well.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think that playing off of that goes into Angle just being such a great fucking babyface as well. Angle being one of the few guys, and this is why like Angle is a Hall of Famer just of anything, is that he was able to switch so effortlessly after Invasion into being the biggest babyface in the company. And he had finally reached his peak here. And I think with Austin, and why this match makes so much sense, is because Austin knows he can't beat Kurt Angle. That is the story. He knows he can't beat him. And at least not beat Kurt when he's serious and not the idiot that he's been hanging around with for the past 6 months.
Absolutely. No, I mean, so these matches end up becoming, like, first of all, I love Kurt Angle's gear. Let's talk about that.
Yeah.
The man looks like an Olympic SIM card. Like, but nonetheless, like, he would somehow find a way to make patriotic not seem corny with his gear. He had all-time great singlets, just and this is one of the best by far. 7 German suplexes that Angle delivers.
7.
Angle kicks out of 3 stunners. That is huge.
Ridiculous. Well, you got to think, right, that with Austin, at that point in his career, he was so protective of everything about his gimmick. At that point, Rock had only been the one that kicked out of stunners, right? I think he kicked out of one at X7, right?
Right, yes.
So it was him kind of saying, okay, you're that next guy. And he doesn't do that for everybody. Damn sure not the Taz or anybody else that had been around. But, like, 3 stunners is a lot. I mean, in terms of, like, just saying what Austin was as a character, he was giving a lot to Angle. And I think it made him all the better for it. It made Angle, like, a bigger star for doing this.
A wrestling machine. I mean, I'm still... Everything in this match and kind of how it's played out, it boggles your mind that Kurt Angle debuts 18 months before this, because I can't think of anyone who debuts on the main roster 18 months before, and not like main roster, because a lot of people go through NXT now. I'm talking about you debuted pretty much on a major stage at period and having these matches. It's incredible. Like, they talk about one of the fastest people to understand the business. I think it's because he understands the business on a level that's not just let's hit the moves and impress the crowd. He understands it from a psychological standpoint. And while I think Austin was doing a lot of the heavy lifting in this match and kind of, like, you know, overall calling the thing, it's Kurt Angle's performance during this entire match that truly makes this a very special match. And we talk about, you know, the non-inclusion of blood. I think blood made this match so much better.
Absolutely. Like, the desperation of Austin to do any fucking thing that he could to get out of this match.
Right.
Was seen.
Go ahead. No, go ahead.
And I think that, like, when it gets to the point where Austin, because he started doing the $1 million dream again. He does that. That was a great fucking call. When he attacks the referee to get a DQ and it does not happen. That's, and it's like, I know who was winning this, but it's like, the way they got there was just so great. So the point where it's just like, I wasn't even mad at, you know, where it leads to at the end.
Mm-hmm. Well, it ends up being, if you ask Meltzer, I think ends up giving this 4.5 stars. And he says he only takes off that half because of the finish. But I can see why, because this match is kind of, it ends up being kind of left kind of inconclusive in a sense. Because it was shenanigans finish and stuff like that. But I mean, they told the story so well, and I think a major reason why we were left with that inconclusive finish is because this didn't close the pay-per-view, which shocked me at the time.
Yeah,
because I swore it was going to be Kurt Angle versus Stone Cold Steve Austin at the end of this pay-per-view.
Is Vince coming for you?
He might.
Yeah, I think in hindsight, watching this 2021, knowing what happens after, knowing all of that, it's easy for me to still give this 5 stars because we know what happens after. We know why they made this decision, because there was a bigger moment that would be happening after this. And this was the return of, you know, one of their biggest stars after months of being gone.
Yeah. This was The Rock's return pay-per-view. Like, this was, he's on the poster. He's with a lot of the promotion. He's in Hollywood. They wanted to make the attraction The Rock. But this match itself, I mean, doesn't get talked about quite nearly enough, man. This is really, 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 really good. Mm-hmm. I know when Kurt Angle pulls out a moonsault, that means it's time to go. It's a big money match. Like,
that's when you know?
That's when you know. That's when anyone should know, to be quite honest with you. The end of this match sees Stone Cold Steve Austin takes out a ref, of course. Kurt Angle comes. He also takes out a ref. Nick Patrick comes down and DQs Kurt Angle because of the previous ref thing. And instead of actually calling the match, you know, as it is, he ends up DQing it for, you know, taking out the ref earlier. Whew. Austin escapes, literally escapes.
Runs out.
Grabs his champion. Yeah. That's why he's such a good cat. Like, this is why, and I'm going to talk about it in the next episode because I'm finally getting into the Austin heel episode.
Oh, man.
This is something, you know me. This is one of my favorite things. I can do an entire episode about this, which I will. But he did so many things. He understood the role. It's just unfortunate that people really didn't want to boo him.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Well, I'll give you this. They did boo him here. They were booing him here.
Yes. Yes.
They were. And I think that this was one of the only, I feel like they finally got someone that, boom, okay, we will boo. Like, there's only two people, I think, in the company right now they'll boo Austin against. It's Rock and Angle. And they had to build up to that. And Angle became the other guy here. So, like, they did boo him. And especially in the finish, they booed him because they were white hot. They wanted Angle to win this match and win the title, rather. But they didn't get it, and they were upset about it. So I do think that they did succeed on that role.
Absolutely. Let's talk about the main event. And then we'll head into some Wrestler Observer Newsletter talk to kind of cap off this episode. Yep. Main event, The Rock versus Booker T for the WCW championship. A great promo leading up to this, by the way. And I think truly, Booker T has never looked bigger, badder, and probably better in the whole entire WCW run as he did building up to this match. Him just having this encounter with The Rock, I think did wonders for his career.
Yeah, it did. And him being on the damn show every fucking week, also, and running those laps, and them not giving up on him after he hurt Austin, and, you know, it was an accident, but, like, you know, them really putting all of their effort behind him, putting him in the big heel faction, they built him up perfectly for this moment, and
he played the role perfectly as well.
Exactly. I mean,
he put his entire, you know, it was obvious that compared to The Rock, I mean, they did these things where they did these vignettes where Booker T would go out for auditions to audition for movies as well. And he'd be like, you know, of course, and I'm better than The Rock. You know what I'm saying? Like, oh, that's your. And, you know, people would obviously be like, oh, my God, you know The Rock? And he would get mad. Yeah. And they were building up that thing of, like, he felt, I guess, that he wasn't inadequate towards The Rock. And you saw, you know, he began to step it up, even with the little things, like the little sweatsuits that he would wear, similar to The Rock sweatsuits, and the outfits that he'd wear, the little, you know, he stepped up in terms of, like, actual, like, you know, looking, and compared to most people in the invasion, he looked good.
Because it was the idea that when you watch WCW, at least in my neighborhood, Booker T was like the WCW rock. He had the bookend. Mm-hmm. He had the spinneroonie. He had all of that, the theatrics. This, to me as a kid, was the culmination of these two major black men coming together. Finally, this was the dream match. You know, like Goldberg Austin, Hogan Austin. For me, it was always Booker T, Rock, because those two were alike. Booker T was my favorite in WCW. Rock was my favorite, you know, one of my favorites in WWF. And we had a conversation in Discord about, like, well, you know, they only pushed Booker because, you know, he was the only guy left. And I was just like, no. I was like, Booker was that guy for them. He was the last guy who had the WCW championship before the whole thing folded. He was the guy. And they managed to get him, and they pushed him like he was the guy throughout his tenure there.
Absolutely. Absolutely. First main event featuring two African-Americans for a world championship. On a major pay-per-view. Great, you know, good match, solid match. I popped for the APA spot.
Yeah.
You know.
It was good.
It was a good callback. A good callback for Shane McMahon finally getting his comeuppance.
This was the Rock getting his shit off and getting back into shape. Yeah. This is what it was.
Yeah.
It was literally a bunch of like rest holds and fucking Booker T kind of getting his shit off, but it was the Rock
getting his axe kicks in and all types of shit.
Yeah, like that's what it was. Rock selling, and it wasn't a lot like on the Rock's end. That's why I was like, this to me was like a lesser of the two matches that we just saw. It was to me.
Yeah.
If that was a five, this is like a three to end the show. Like the really big
part
was the ending and seeing all of the Rock shit, and you know, for the first time in what, 6-7 months. So,
Rock wins the WCW championship to cap off the show. Suddenly to JR, it's like WWF is, we're back in business, baby. We got a world championship now. Now we're on even plane. You have our belt. We have your belt. You know what I'm saying? Like, and I truly believe. This was, I don't know where it was supposed to go. This was supposed to lead back to Austin versus Rock.
Ugh.
And it never happens.
Would have been dope.
Yeah. I'm going to start off. Okay. So we're going to do the Wrestling Observer Newsletter section.
Yes.
This is a section that I just came up with. Not came up with, but just discovered once I discovered some newsletters. But nonetheless, I think it was some interesting tidbits that people can definitely look towards. Let's see. I'm going through the August 6th one. Hold on. Here we go. Oh, they talk about Acclaim in the ECW. They talk about a lot of Acclaim in ECW. The Return of the Rock drew the highest rated segment in nearly a year and boosted Raw to the second highest rating they've done since moving to TNN. Due to the added number of homes with TNN skewing the ratings, there were more viewers watching the show, making it the most watched show in the history of TNN. And that is probably why The Rock ends up main eventing this pay-per-view because of all the eyes that was on this match. There's a couple other things on here. Conan has been pretty much iced out of Mexico due to his press problems with CMLL and AAA. We would never see Conan in a WWE ring.
So, he don't like
him. I mean, well,
he don't like them.
Yeah. let's see what else. Let's see what else here. Some TV changes happened for WWF. Both Superstars and Live Wire morning shows are being dropped. And in exchange, WWF will be getting a 2-hour Saturday night time slot. This lets TNN add WWF program within the prime time window, which make TNN appear to be doing stronger numbers, similar to Livewire and Superstars, mostly just recap shows with some other matches. Of course, this would become the legendary show that was Velocity in WWE Confidential.
Yeah, there's one thing that WWF loved. It was goddamn clip shows. And with jobbers wrestling.
Yeah, easily. August 6th, Stacy Carter and Jerry Lawler split up about 3 weeks ago. You gotta be trash, man. You quit for your wife and then you split up with your wife like 4 months later.
How pathetic. That was like the biggest, like, all right, keeping it real goes wrong type moment. Like, come on, nigga.
China made a post on her website responding all the stories about her alleged contract demands and reasons for leaving WWF. Dave said the problem with this story is that no one will definitively say anything, and it's a bunch of vague hints. China said that she did not want to go backwards, and WWF wasn't offering her what she felt she deserved. Dave talks about her Playboy success as well as her autobiography selling well, and that she was making a ton of money this year because of that. China said WWF turned down her offer because Vince now has a monopoly on the business and doesn't have to give in to people's contract demands anymore. China made it clear that she didn't quit, she was released. She also said that she did not want to wrestle full-time anymore, wanted to pursue acting, which was a factor. WWF doesn't want to pay full-time, big guaranteed money to a part-time actor. Dave says they did with The Rock, but points out that China's star power isn't even in The Rock's league, despite what she apparently thinks.
It wasn't Cap.
It wasn't Cap. I mean, Rock was on Whose Line? You know what I'm saying? And finally, even though no one will outright admit it, China being the odd one out in this Triple H and 70-man situation had a lot to do with it.
Well, I mean, it is definitely odd, you know, period.
Yeah.
That whole relationship. So, yeah, I get it. But I'm not going to say, like, have you seen the documentary that they came out?
No, I haven't yet.
Saw a couple.
I think the Triple... And believe it or not, I think Triple H in China had an MTV diary as well.
Yeah, they did. It was I'm a pro wrestler. It was them. I think Tony Atlas was one of them. It had people that were pop on like TV and people who were like in the indies. And I think Tony Atlas was one of them. Yeah.
Jesus Christ. Various WWF notes. The Rock's wife is due to give birth this month.
Simone.
As we know.
Simone
would be born. Simone Johnson. Shout out to Simone Johnson, who is now in NXT. Also, Nathan Jones hasn't cleared up his visa issues in Australia. Sharmell Sullivan signs to WWF. Let's see what else is going on in the old newsletter. August 13th. I'm moving August 13th. I'm going to skip a lot of this stuff. They talk about the Invasion pay-per-view buys, which was fucking fantastic, as I've already told you earlier.
Yeah.
The bankruptcy situation surrounding ECW is now on hold until October, to at which point the court will decide on Acclaim's attempts to take over ECW's assets. So Acclaim tried to really grab the ECW stuff. Everyone was like, no, but you owe us money. This whole thing is like, you owe us money.
It's a mess. Like, yeah. And it would not get cleared up until like, shit, fucking year and a half, maybe 2 years after that. So this continues to be an issue going forward while Paul sits pretty as a writer on SmackDown. And that's a wild nigga, man. Like if you wanted to beat Paul Heyman ass, you had all the right to do so.
You knew where to find them. They posted little calendars every week on the show. Next week, SmackDown will feature new graphics and a new set. I remember when that debuted, I was like, oh my God, the fist.
Money.
Oh my God.
That money.
Let's see. Jim Ross met with Rey Mysterio and Juventud Guerrero this week.
How did that conversation?
The meeting was apparently supposed to be Mysterio because WWF scheduled that one, which means they're planning to hire him. Guerrero, I guess, just tagged along.
That was Ray trying to get his man's a bag, man. I fuck with that. He was trying to get his man a bag. That's what's up.
Anyway, everyone in WWF recognizes Guerrero's talent, but the drug arrest in Australia last year is still a big thing holding him from being signed. It also notes at the end of this, Paul Heyman will make his acting debut in the movie Rollerball, which comes out next year.
And he did do that.
And I never saw it.
He's in it for like...
I know. It's not long, I heard.
Yeah, it's like 2 minutes.
The WWF.com domain, this is the last one, the August 20th Wrestling Observer. WWF.com web domain, as well as other potential uses of WWF initials, are in jeopardy after a London court ruled against the WWF in a lawsuit filed by the other WWF, the World Wildlife Fund.
Uh-oh.
So apparently they were told they had this agreement with the World Wildlife Fund that they wouldn't use the name outside of the country. And outside of the United States, they would only refer to themselves as the World Wrestling Federation and not the WWF. Of course, the WWF, the real one, says, fuck that. And we do whatever we want. To which the World Wildlife Fund was like, no, you didn't. And apparently the website domain ends up becoming an issue because they're particularly annoyed by the internet domain WWF.com while the fund is WWF.org. The WWF argued that changing their domain could cost them as much as $50 million since it's an established domain. The judge was unmoved and even mentioned how WWF lawyers had an astonishingly poor and hopeless argument.
Damn it, McDammit.
The court ruled that the WWF mostly abided by the agreement until 1997, at which point they just started flagrantly ignoring it. Thus this lawsuit.
It was on a roll. Fuck it. Fuck them rules, man.
Fuck it. We make it back. let's see. They talk about the G1. I'm gonna skip that, unfortunately. Sorry. They bought WCW for $2.5 million, which was incredibly cheap.
Bought them for a steak meal. Bought them for a Five Guys meal.
let's see. Alex Wright. You remember Alex Wright? The one Das Wonder Kid?
Yeah. Never showed
up? He stayed in. He decided to stay in the U.S. because his WCW contract doesn't expire until next year.
Fuck it.
Fuck it. Listen, they were making up to $18,000 per week. Like, it didn't. Some of these people were making $18,000 per week. So
stupid. I mean, you see what the ramifications of that type of thing does when you see what WWE does when they release people, when they hoard all these people and they don't do anything with them. And then you see how much they make. It's like, fuck, Braun Strowman is making what?
That's a fact. The long-term plan of splitting the WWF into two brands doesn't have a timetable yet, but almost certainly won't take place before the end of this year. It obviously happened
in 2002.
Let's see. Notes from Raw. Jericho made fun of Stephanie McMahon's new breast implants, complete with before and after pics. Dave notes that Stephanie was on the Opie and Anthony show and talked about seeing a sign in the crowd that said saggy puppies, which was one of their keys into making her make a decision to get them done. I remember that interview.
Fucking, she a freak. That was what that interview, you know, that was some freak shit.
Go find it. Literally go find it.
Literally go find that. Go find it. I can't give you much more than that.
Yeah. Rey Mysterio met with Jim Ross and John Laurinaitis last week at SmackDown show in LA. Again, Juventud Guerrero was with Mysterio, but he did not have a meeting scheduled. Mysterio still has the WCW contract that runs out for the end of the year. Ross told Mysterio to keep his WCW deal for now and to stay in shape, and when it expires, he'll talk to him again in January, especially since they might be splitting the roster at that point. After the meeting, Guerrero basically cornered Jim Ross at catering and asked for a job, which isn't exactly this might be cap, which isn't exactly proper protocol. Ross basically told him the same thing as Mysterio: try back again in January.
Listen, man, he also need this. I such a
He also said that while they love Guerrero's talent, they won't put up with any of the drug issues. Guerrero swore he doesn't have a problem, but of course, everyone that has a problem says that, so he's got to stay clean a while to prove it. That's fucked up to say, Dave. Paul Heyman said he would go to bat for him as well. Let's see. Eddie Guerrero is still in rehab for drug and alcohol issues. There's no timetable for his return. WWF has given him all the time he needs. I think he would be released maybe towards the end of the year, beginning of the following year. Shawn Michaels did an interview with the Winnipeg Sun and said he has no desire to ever wrestle again. Called himself a dinosaur in the business. He says, my personal feeling is I don't want to wrestle again because I don't want to get hurt. And then
he came back and had a run of runs.
Run of runs. That's this episode, man.
Yeah. Listen.
SummerSlam 2001. It was a big one. This is a big one. We had a lot to talk about. We had a lot of fun discussing this. I don't know if plans change when doing this Invasion Diaries. But the next episode is supposed to be the breakout stars of the Invasion, winners and losers. So we'll discuss. Well, no, it's actually supposed to be the Stone Cold Steve Austin. I keep forgetting.
Yeah.
The Evil Stone Cold and then the breakout stars. So we're going to talk about the Evil Stone Cold and then we're going to talk about the breakout stars. The Evil Stone Cold one next week, if you want to watch it beforehand, will be taking place the night after SummerSlam during Austin Appreciation Night. And I think you all know what happens on that night. But until then, of course, thank you, J5, for doing this once again.
Anytime.
And yeah, this was an Invasion Diaries Chapter 5. Thank you guys for tuning in. We got a couple more episodes left. But until then, let your friends know that you can binge them. You can get ready for them. It's once per week. Keep subscribed to the Patreon at the HRNC. Follow the HRNC on Twitter. Follow myself at Meals TV and Justin at OG Johnny 5. And yeah, we got more things coming down the pipeline. The A Show every week. We'll see you guys later. Take care.
504-972-713. What you gonna do? You checking out the scene, I'm checking a hold it now. With perpendicular vehicular homicide. 314-201. Too much green, too much fun. I Bangkok and Bangkok. Can't stop, I turn and hit the same spot. Think not? I'm the Thriller in Manila. Slong in Hong Kong. Pimp them like Bishop, Magic, Don Juan. Man, after Henny with a Coke and a smile, I just pick up the motherfucking phone and dial. I got my condoms in a big ass sack. I'm slanging this dick like a new jack.
Is it cause they like my gangster wall?
Gangster wall.
Is it cause they like my gangster tall?
Gangster tall.
Is it cause they like my handsome face?
Handsome face.
Is it cause they like my gangsta way?
Gangsta way.
Ooh. Whatever it is, they love it and they just won't let me be. Won't I handle my fears. Don't rush me, just relax and let me be free. Whenever I call. Come running 212 or 213. You know that I ball. Stop running. I'll call my substitute free. I got holes.
I've got holes
in different area codes.
Area codes.
Holes,
holes, holes
in different area codes.
Area
codes. I've got holes.
916-415-704. Shout out to the 206. Everybody in the 808. Ha, ah. 216-702-414. 317-214s and the 281s. 334-205. I see y'all. 318 and the 601s. 203-804. 402. 301-904-407. 850-708-502. Holes in different area codes. Know that. Southern hospitality. Northern exposure. Whole riding on the West Coast. You understand what I'm saying? Hocus pocus. You the dopest. Holes to the right. Holes to the left. Five holes this time. Woo! Oh no. Hip-hop holocaust, that's what we on right now. No need to get all ho style. Yeah! Woo! Def Jam South, baby. Disturbing the peace. Jazzy Feezy. Uncle Face. Ludacris. Hoes. I'm sweating like a motherfucker.